Hello there, good afternoon, and welcome to the Economic Times Human Capital Conclave presented by SAP. Thank you all for joining us. My big thanks to all the panelists and all the speakers of this conclave and all the people who are attending to listen in to us. My name is Alokesh Bhattacharya. I am senior editor of the Economic Times, and I will host today's program. We have a very exciting agenda ahead of us. We have a keynote address, there's a case study presentation, and then we'll have a very stimulating panel discussion on building the workforce of tomorrow. Let us start with the keynote address. I would like to invite Ashish Shetri, Vice President, Human Resources and Systems at Asian Paints. Ashish heads both HR and IT functions of the company, which is a combination that is increasingly being seen in Indian enterprises. I can see it especially in automobiles. In the paints industry, Ashish, you must be an exception unless there are others that I don't know of. And Ashish will talk to us today about building an agile organization in a VUCA world, among other things. Ashish, over to you. You need to unmute.
Okay. So we are still getting used to it, I guess. So good afternoon, everybody. And thank you, Alokesh, for the opportunity. And thank you, SAP, for giving me this opportunity today. It's mentioned as a keynote, but my objective today is just to lay down the groundwork for what we may want to discuss in the next hour and a half. I think, as you said, we have a very eminent panel from across leaders, across the industry, from HR as well as from other facets in this discussion. So I'll just try and keep it extremely short, just for some food for thought. No presentation or any topic today can be discussed without the backdrop of the pandemic and what we have gone through in the last 1 year, maybe even slightly more now. And that's going to form the basic of what I'm going to do here. I'm just trying to get my screen up. Just give me a moment.
Sure.
Yeah. Okay. Can you see it?
Yep. Yeah.
Okay. So building a workforce for tomorrow. All of us as organizations have great strategies and things put in place to ensure that we are prepared for a workforce for tomorrow. But I'm sure every one of us would have experienced this. All workforce strategies had literally to be ripped apart post the pandemic. The way we are interacting today, the way the skills are required in this period, totally changed. And I think that was the cornerstone. And maybe the last 14 odd months has made us much more wiser in terms of how we are going to build this workforce strategy going forward. The fundamentals at times would still remain the change, but I think the learnings of the last 1 year would definitely have shaped the way we would have looked at creating the workforce for the future. And I think I'll just touch upon one or two elements of that that comes to my mind. Clearly, these are two words that all of us would have experienced: resilience and agility. And you would have found a lot of business leaders really talking about these two words, which has clearly defined how organizations have been able to respond to the pandemic and really come out stronger or weaker at the end of it. Now, this is this is a combination of not just the technology or the people in the organization, but it's all about the business model, the way, the ability of the organization to respond. But I think today's discussion is clearly focused on how resilient and agility we have looked at in the human capital or in the people of the organization, and how that becomes even more important as we go along. So I just like to focus on these two. It's always important. Sometimes it's always important and nice to get a definition out of the way. So resilience in my mind is the ability to resist, absorb, recover, and adapt to disruption. So if you see, the words are carefully chosen. It's about first resisting, absorbing, recovering, and then adapting, right? And that's how resilience is all about. It is something that can be adapted to an organization and a lot of the business models that go along with it. But I think in the context of today, it's also about each one of us as individuals and also as learning organizations, as how we are really going to absorb, recover, and adapt to this disruption. it's clearly an insurance policy for times of disruption. So that's all about resilience and how resilience is important for any organization to cater to or to manage times of disruption. And this resilience, I would like to frame, is really depends on your agility to respond to some of the disruptions that are happening. Now, this is not something new. I think the picture on the right clearly says it. I mean, the ways of working really changed, in the last 1 year, and clearly new skills adopted, and as simple as working on platforms like this to even more complex when supply chains and customer touch points clearly changed a lot. And different organizations would have adopted to it very differently. But I think as individuals, as well, I think it has been a great learning phase. And I think that really forms a very good basis from how we are going to shape each of our organizations from a learning perspective and also from a skilling perspective going forward. Just some data more, just to reiterate the point of how important this is. This is a slide I picked up from one of the Gartner analysts, and they really said that before COVID-19, 55% of organizations were focused on efficiency as a priority. But what does efficiency really get us? It really makes us very lean, and if I may use the expression, it really makes us fragile. Because you are so lean, the ability to withstand any process breakdown because of any disruption becomes even more difficult. So that's a learning for us.
Ashish, yeah. Can you just speak up a little bit?
You're not able to hear me well?
It's a little volume on the lower side.
Okay, is it better now?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'll just repeat the last 30 seconds or so. So before COVID-19, clearly 55% of organizations were focused on efficiency as a priority, like all organizations do. Reduce costs, get in efficiency, improve the effectiveness, which really make you lean. And, making you lean also makes you fragile as an organization, right? Processes, can break down because of disruption. So that's an important learning. So one food for thought as we go along is how do you become more resilient and at the same time be efficient? Because the number of disruptions, and that's the slide on the right-hand side, which clearly shows the number of disruptions that each one of us may have or will experience as we go along. The Suez Canal has been in the news in the last 10 days, and people who are closely looking at supply chains, I'm sure, will realize that the disruption of 6 days is going to last you more than 25 days in terms of disruptions that could happen to supply chains by one small ship, or I shouldn't say small, but one large ship choking the Suez Canal, right? So I'm talking of these kind of disruptions increasingly happening, and whether it's weather, whether it is natural disasters, whether it is a pandemic of this nature, but clearly the number of disruptions predicted is important, is going to increase, and hence the resilience of an organization to withstand some of that and come out of that really is different. I'll just pause for a moment and maybe just mention one or two examples that came about, just to amplify the point about how some organizations being resilient and learning really adapted to this scenario. You would know that a lot of the service industry, which was probably the most affected, the hotel, the airlines, really did not have business models to be able to manage this shock. But if there was an organization that Hilton actually did not look at any layoffs and furloughs in this period, and really tied up with some other organizations where they did a lot of talent sharing, and they were able to in great speed see how their people could contribute in other organization and hence retain them. And I'm sure they will benefit from the upswing as it comes along. So different strategies adopted by by the organization to manage some of this. Obviously, there are examples of Amazon, who obviously benefited from a model of the disruption where people were spending far greater time at home and increased the workforce in the organization. But coming back and laying the context of how as an organization we need to be resilient and get in a lot of agility, I thought it's important to just look at this framework and to look at, you know, what clearly could be strategies to adopt to build this resilient organization, right? I like to just put it in three, you know, three broad buckets. Creating a blended workforce right now. Gone are the days where you had only permanent employees as part of your, you know, of an organization. The workforce for tomorrow, I think when we look at agility, scalability, cost, and performance, we'll really look at permanent workforce at one end to say a gig workers at the other end. So that's one clear trend. And in between, there would be many more class of, you know, employees. It could be outsourced, which anyway we do a lot. It could be vendor organizations that we partner more. A lot of data also tells us that organizations are using consumers as gig workers, right? And making consumers adapt to their way of working in a digital environment and trying to see how that can get enabled far better. So very clearly a trend of how the constituent of the workforce typically is, right? Right from a permanent at one end to a, you know, gig at the other end. As Alokesh said, I come from the technology world. Clearly, the workforce is going to get a lot more non-traditional resources. And I put one more data point below, which says that, you know, as of today, only about 5% of work done is by non-traditional, resources. But by the year 2029, you may find that about 28% of work getting done by non-traditional resources. Now, what do I mean by non-traditional resources? It could be, you know, it could be non-permanent employees, it could be gig workers, but a technology or, you know, AI-enabled resources and the way we manage some of these digital employees, so as to say, will also change significantly. So it's not about, you know, trying to say that everything will get replaced, but the ability to respond to consumers and create a working model to enable a blended workforce where some of this automation and AI-enabled stuff is used along with the existing workforce, I think will become a very clear trend, for the future. That's why I've tried to put down the element of, you know, we really need to see how we augment, the business or the blended workforce, how we enable it to work in the organization, and clearly look at ways to make this far more productive in terms of how this interface is handled. Being away from a consumer touch point is going to be extremely different. I'll just quote one, you know, personal example that we faced as an organization. You know, we are now entering into the business of decor, and you need to get into people's homes and advise them on design. And in the year of the pandemic, we just didn't have a consumer touch point to enable people interact with our designers. And the designers are so used to interacting with people across the table and, you know, to be able to demonstrate a design and see the reaction. And, you know, we really had to move and skill them to move towards a virtual selling environment, right? So, you know, it's not about just the putting an AI-enabled workforce, but how do you skill people to work in an environment which is very different, while design is their main element of the role, but it's also about how you're interfacing with the end consumer and touching base with him or her in the process of, you know, of the design element. So again, just to summarize, looking at a blended workforce where there are people in different spectrum of the, you know, workforce, and at the same time, really looking at technology as a key enabler and the dexterity of employees to be able to manage this technology, I think, is a key enabler for the, you know, for tomorrow's workforce. So this is all about the non-traditional, resources. I'll just spend, this slide on, you know, what the traditional resources would be. And the two data points on top, I thought, are quite relevant in today's context, which really talks about 30% of the skills needed to do a job in 2017 will be obsolete by 2021, right? So clearly, new skills coming in, but I think more importantly, the right-hand side is equally important, where the total number of skills required for a single job is increasing by 10% year on year. So it's like saying that to manage your current role itself, or to manage the current role played by a person, 10% of new skills will really need to get acquired. Now, what does this really mean for an organization? Is you know, gone are the days where you could rely on just acquiring skills and changing people's domain to be able to get that done. It's also about how clearly on the existing role itself, people have to get skilled as the technology changes and as the consumer interface changes. I'm just taking an example from the consumer end. That's an industry I know of, but I'm sure that will span across all the roles and in an organization. So clearly, a way to look at how to build a dynamic skill system. How fast can you absorb some of these skills into the organization? Some of the trends which I see getting increasingly important are going to be how experience can quickly be used in an organization, right? It's about how you are able to skill people. Like for example, in our organization, we really use train the trainer as a really key concept. And I think that is going to get even more relevant in the years to come in the future, as how quickly some of this will really get absorbed in the organization is going to be important. Another trend I see is about creating fusion teams and how smaller teams across domains and across the typical silos in organization can be used to not only get the work done with agility, but at the same time really build upon the learning that each one of them has while working in such fusion teams. I think that's going to be increasingly important to acquire not just skills of the domain in which you're working, but clearly getting adapted to other parts of the organization so that the responsiveness or the agility of the organization really improves. So that I thought was some of the thoughts that I had on what this pandemic or what the future of the workforce will clearly look at, traditional as well as non-traditional resources within the traditional, how fast you seep in the skills, because the rate at which some of the digital dexterity will really drive getting the skills is going to get increasingly important. And in the non-traditional areas, typically you will look at a very different workforce in the spectrum of people that will join the organization. And when you have to manage that, since they will deal with various very critical aspects, I think that that is an extremely important element. So these were my thoughts, Alokesh, just to get the ball rolling. Thank you.
Thank you, Ashish. You can stop sharing the screen. They're very, very interesting points you made there. And some of them are very relevant. In fact, I had jotted them down also for the panel discussion that we're going to have later. One of the things I noticed is that you spoke about agility and you spoke about resilience. And I think probably it's mixed in there, but probably a third thing that I would think about is flexibility. Because I think flexibility is one of the things that has marked out the response of organizations to this pandemic. And now when we are seeing this huge resurgence, right? I mean, we thought that COVID was gone, almost gone, but now it has come back with a vengeance, right? Very ferocious kind of second, third, fourth waves going on all around us. And it's probably as dangerous, if not more, than it was before. So flexibility is one of the things that, I'd also like to take away from there. Your point on fusion teams was very interesting to me, because I can see since you're IT, I was expecting that to come from you, because I had a couple of discussions with the cloud people, and this whole thing of getting a non-hierarchical, non-function based, project based team structures is something that organizations are moving towards, right? So it's like get people with the skill set. Doesn't matter whether they're in HR or this or which department they are in, right? There's the concept of the purple people, where people who are equally adept at both technology and business, right? These are the new kind of people who are coming in and changing organizations. Very, very core points. There was also a question that has come from Ritika, who's saying she was not sure about how this model that you spoke of, right, of the non-traditional kind of workers. And their share getting more in the workforce, whether that is going to work out even in a service industry scenario?
Sure, I think the service industry anyway is used to a lot of partnerships, and the delivery in the service industry is there already. I think it's more in the you know, the traditional manufacturing CPG kind of industries where the adoption of maybe this is still lesser. So their cycles also go, you know, from a scalability angle also is not very linear. So I would say that yes, it would get, you know, adopted across all industries.
Okay. And do you think this combination of gigs, you know, the gig economy, the rising gig economy and automation is going to necessarily result in leaner workforces for organizations going forward? And the fact that, you know, each job is also going to get 10% more complex in terms of skill sets.
Yeah. So I think, I think the mobility of people will definitely need to get considered, right? When we are looking at, you know, organizations. So you use the word flexibility. I think that's the other element, right? Of how flexible you are as an individual and also in terms of an organization to be able to leverage some of those, you know, skills.
Correct. Thank you so much, Ashish, for your keynote. It was really wonderful. Please do stay with us for the rest of the program while we move on to the next session. Thank you very much. Okay, so from Ashish, we now come to Sanjay. Sanjay Singh is the Global Chief Human Resource Officer of UPL. And I'm really looking forward to this one, Sanjay, from you. You know, Sanjay will explain today how UPL successfully managed the cultural integration of itself with an acquired company, right? An M&A. It's one of the most difficult things in HR. And what are the lessons that Sanjay has for us as we listen to him? Over to you, Sanjay.
Thank you, Lukesh. Thank you so much. I hope you can hear me.
Yes, we can.
So I'm happy to be sharing some of the insights here. I also want to thank Ashish and his notions about agility, disruption, fragility. I mean, these are soft concepts, but when they hit you very hard. One of the things that we really learned about the COVID-19 pandemic is that it did not allow the hegemony or the power of organizations to run the way they wanted to run. You know, a pandemic took it over and, you know, the frameworks failed. And when the frameworks failed, we had a massive global experimentation and flexibility, because even if the employers or those hegemons wanted everybody to be in the office at the same time, it was not possible. And therefore, it gave us like a mass scale human experimentation, of which, as Alokesh, you said, flexibility has turned out to be a big learning. The other big learning is that let people choose what is best for them. Let them figure out their own survival, but let them also figure out their own productivity and effectiveness. And that is the model which is actually working very well, because the system is so volatile. The disease can impact anyone, that you are forced or you are encouraged to let the person take the call on an individual basis about his health and then about his survival, about his income, and about all these things. So I think we're having a great time in terms of creating data. And, you know, then the smart people are smart people and the not so ones are the not so ones, which is like you get the data, you take insights, and then you create a new architecture. And Thomas Kuhn used to call it, you know, the power of changing paradigms. So I think the paradigm is going to shift and the smart ones are going to take a note of it and they are going to put it in place before the other ones follow suit. So thank you, Ashish. I think it was great. And I think Asian Paints have been a marquee company which leads HR in many areas, has been there for a long time. But let me shift gears and try to talk to you all about or share our thoughts about, you know, how in our sector, which is the agrochemical space, we had 2-3 major acquisitions, which is Dow DuPont, which is called Corteva, Bayer Monsanto, in LBA our own small way, and how the pressure of learning and the pressure of and the insights from the failure of others, it really made us prepare very well to make the cultural integration, you know, a success. So UPL in 2018, on 20th July 2018, acquired a company called Arista. Arista was a $1.9 billion top line company for a consideration of $4.2 billion, while at the same time UPL was $2.7 billion. So it was essentially more or less, you know, a merger of equals or an acquisition of an equal. So if you really look at all the data, which essentially says that you know, it's like two set of families coming together, two set of cultures coming together. Like, you know, we say American culture, German culture, French are very different from German. Germans are very different from Japanese. But essentially, when companies came together, and these are the part of a famous case study of Daimler, Chrysler, and all that, that if you don't integrate the top level culture very well, you actually lose a lot of value. But if you integrate it well, you actually multiply the value by 3x times. And it also shows that companies which are very, very focused on a healthy cultural integration do see a massive 9% EBITDA growth after the first year. And then, culture is like a very vague term, but culture to me essentially means that your preponderant behavior, that keeping everything else equal, given a chance, how would you behave? So keeping everything equal, would you want to control people or would you want to decentralize people? But we also find that healthy cultures actually explain more than 50% of companies' performance. Coming back to UPL and why UPL acquired Arista Life Sciences. So UPL was number 7th in the sector before the acquisition. And globally, today sustainability has become very important. You see global warming, you see the temperature going up by 1.5 to 2 degrees. Then you see people coming with Kyoto Protocol and the Paris Accord, and then they are committing to saving carbons and trying to commit to, bring down the global temperatures by 1.5 to 2 degrees, and it requires a lot of effort from their side. You also see that as part of the same sustainability movement that we cannot use the same chemicals for a long time in the same soil because it has a relatively permanent adverse impact. And therefore, there is a focus on bringing organics or what we call as sustainables. That means try to use a biodegradable, try to use an animal extract or a plant extract to ensure that you use natural means and you don't try to damage the environment. So you give to your children and your granddaughter an environment which was better than what you got, and at least as good as what you got. You give them as much water that as you had when you were born, and you give them as much clear air to breathe as you had when you were born. So this Arista was a company which was a little marquee, eclectic company, which was made of multiple acquisitions. They were very high in the sustainable space. They had plant extracts, animal extracts, and and products made out of that, which act as biofertilizers or biopesticides. They had special factories of honeybee extracts or seaweed extracts. So we wanted to acquire that to ensure that we became the number one leading player in the sustainable space, and we actually became with this acquisition. The second was essentially around the geographical spreads. We were very strong on the Western Europe or North America, a bit in Brazil and all that, but Arista was very strong in Russia, CIS, in Africa's, in Eastern Europe, and parts of LATAM that we were not very strong. But this actually gave us the opportunity to become number one in Chile, number one in Mexico and other countries. And the third was that in UPL actually always believed in doing production inside, while Arista basically worked on a model of network of networks. So they had a lot of partners doing manufacturing for them, but we had become so big that we felt that in addition to doing backward integration, we need to partner with multiple firms to create global manufacturing capability. So it just came like a natural fit. And you would see the advantage of that when to the surprise of most of the people who were watching us, we showed a growth in the first year in top line by more than 10%. So how did we do that? So the first thing we did was that we really put in a very heavy team, which worked very strongly on the cultural bit. We had a group of experts who traveled to 10, 12 countries. They interviewed 30, 40, people, including farmers, employees, vendors, and tried to find out what are the strong points of Arista culture, what are the strong points of UPL culture. And then they said, these are your common points, and try to build your culture on the new common point. The second thing which we did is that we said, we are not going to refer to our past. Once we become one company, so we came up with a new set of purpose, new set of vision, new set of values, new set of everything. We said, no reference to the past. Don't say, in my company, performance management system was like that. In my company, marketing strategy was built like that. So we said, let's be future driven rather than trying to be historically anchored. So around that, so if we initially come up with a new purpose, which is what we called as Open Ag, which is, you know, an agriculture network which feeds sustainable growth for everyone, no limits, no borders. So we are open to working with universities, with the startups, you know, with new people, so that, you know, we really build a great set of knowledge. We felt that in today's world, if you want to do everything internally, you would fail. So it was all essentially based on the idea of humility and acceptance of the other. So with that in mind, we tried to build our new strategy, which is new set of cultural goal around both performance and behaviors. So we said, with the new purpose, with the new values, with the new vision, these are the behaviors you need. And with this integrated set of company, these are the new performance, you know, a performance group you need. And the third thing which we did, very important, which was being owned by the CEO at the highest level, was that how do we personally engage? So let's say we had an executive committee of top 7-8 people who were running the company, and then Arista had an executive committee of top 7-8 people running the company. So we had, like, our CEO had, and the senior folks had one-on-one touch with him on the regular checkpoints of how we were evolving the new strategy, how we were evolving the new purpose, and everybody was a part of the team. And yet, you know, what happens when two big companies come together, you know, there are certain exits, but we tried to handle them very sensitively. We tried to engage with them personally. And also we always gave them a choice of being redeployed in the company in some other role, if not in the same role. And many of them actually choose to stay back. So we said, each one of us who's there in the company has reached this level by years of hard work. He does bring something on the table. Let's try to understand him, and let's try to see how does he contribute, and how do we create conditions for him to contribute well. So we continued with some of them in lesser roles. We had some of them working with advisors. Some of them are still working with us as advisors, but we said, we are not going to be too aggressive in saying, oh, we don't have a role for you. We are going to say, oh, we do need you, because, you know, you have earned it for yourself, and you're going to bring in a lot of value. Because if you go away, a lot of the tacit knowledge will go away. So we try to keep it like one stable ship, rather than trying to create like a band-aid effect and try to take it out as soon as, you know, the work was over. And I think that really created a huge cultural glue and cultural trust. So this is basically, I think in the interest of time, I'll run past, but what we did was that we had a top level organization structure design. We shared it with the top 40 people of both the companies. We did the selection of the top team with personal discussions. And then we helped them, you know, select the new people. And then we shared it with everyone. In case of anyone getting selected or not selected, we had one-on-one discussion. It was followed by and championed by the CEO himself. And we felt, let's talk to people and understand a lot more. It did lead to a lot of, a lot of expenditure of time and energy, but I think it was really worth it. And even when people had to leave, they left it with a sense of, with a slightly better sense of what I, what's the right word, a satisfaction or justification. I would not say that they would leave really happily, but we tried to do that. And we felt that there's nothing, some people said you are over communicating, but we said there's nothing called as over communication when it comes to, you know, managing, you know, human beings, especially, you know, when it comes to, you know, they losing their job or livelihood. So this is just a set of slide which tells you the detailed process which was followed. You know, maybe you can read it through, but we shared that particular process, and that particular process was followed in every single case. So the rigor of the exercise actually ensured two things, which is consistency, and the second is the fairness. No, but how do you test consistency and fairness? Because you can say, okay, I was consistent in fairness, and then your claim is as good as my claim, because, you know, but maybe I'm fair and consistent in from my perspective, but you find it completely unfair and inconsistent. But when people saw the new leadership team coming, they saw a completely equal representation of people from both the legacies. In fact, in terms of our regional business heads, we had, you know, I think a much higher percentage, more than 2/3 from the company which was like being acquired, Arista, then from UPL, because we felt it's merit based and it's fair. So in terms of the process, so you can have a detailed process, and the detailed process is aimed at fairness and consistency. But if that does not get reflected in that in the result, you are always thinking about the intention. But in our case, it actually led to a team which had almost equal representation from both the companies. So I think I'm not getting into detail in all this, but one of the things that we really leveraged a lot was top team effectiveness. We did had 18, 19 workshops all across the world, where all the leaders, let's say you have a new team in Latin America with half the people from UPL or from Arista, you have a team in Japan, you have a team in Australia, or you have a team in US. We did 2-day workshop with the help of our consultant where everybody shares his personal life story. And it did really build the team together. And then it also they were also meant to, you know, build a long-term strategy. Similarly, we did have a process where senior leaders from corporate were reaching out to the senior regional team and also addressing them to the global sales and marketing communication to ensure that people are not getting lost because suddenly their leadership at corporate level has changed and they don't know how to reach out to. We also did what I just mentioned, the new flag day. So we started creating the identity of a new company. We consciously strive that we should not have any reference to the old company. So we came up, you know, with the new email IDs, new values, new purpose, new strategy. And then we also had this special initiative for, you know, giving special retention to the top 10% talent. And I think the last was the best, which is we ran a survey, and we ran a survey and we tried to see what is the score of employee engagement from the company that is acquiring, which is UPL, and how does it really compare that with the engagement survey of the company, of the employees of the company that is being acquired. So we used to compare the legacy UPL score with legacy Arista score. So that really turned out to be an exercise which was very insightful and gave us, you know, many action points to act. So I think this is broadly what we achieved in terms of numbers. You know, so we did one survey in August 19, and then we followed us up by a survey in February 20, and we saw the scores moving up by more than 8%. So we saw that people who said, I'm going to work here for more than 2 years, or I'm going to recommend it to the best friend, even from the legacy Arista company, you know, it really improved. So our biggest our biggest positive point, which was coming as qualitative feedback, was that people were getting inspired by our new purpose, which was, you know, OpenAg, which is, you know, open agriculture network that feeds sustainable food for all, no limits, no border. And people were talking more about the future and less about what they have lost or where they came off. And it finally showed up in the numbers. So we in the first year after integration, which was the financial year starting 1st April 19 and ending on 31st March 20, we did have a top line growth of more than 10% and a corresponding EBITDA growth, which was much better than most of our competitors, maybe except one. So that's how it really worked. From the top 20 people, we had only one person, you know, going out with voluntary resignation. And it just showed that all the effort which was put in, you know, through these personal interactions, through these workshops, you know, through knowing their personal lives or life history, it really, and plus talking to people and engaging with them, it really helped us ensure that we don't lose the tacit knowledge of the target being acquired. And today we can say proudly that we are just one, and in fact there are no references to the past. In fact, the COVID-19 pandemic really helped cement the ties further. In fact, you know, the joke is that when you get a big, when you get a huge, dreadful common enemy, you always come together. So I think that also brought us a lot together. So I think that's a great learning for all HR people. I would want to stop here and would be happy to take any questions either now or at the end of the session.
Thank you, Sanjay. It was very, very enlightening. You might want to stop sharing your screen. So is the new company name also different, or is it still UPL?
No, it continues as UPL. The name continues as UPL, yeah.
Okay. And you know, I was just wondering as I was listening to you that while the effort seemed largely, pardon me if I'm mistaken, you can correct me, but effort seemed largely towards addressing the needs of top management and top ranked kind of leaders, right? So my thought was that is that the way culture is driven, in the sense that you make sure that the top guys and the top management and the boards are properly, they understand each other and the rest of the organization just follows? Or is it more difficult to actually integrate the rank and file?
I think it's a very, I would say, intelligent question. So I tried to overproject the part on the top team stability, because it basically sends, it has a signaling and a messaging impact. But we did follow the rigor at every level. But as part of the cultural survey, and that's where I think your question comes very sharp, is that we saw that people who were at middle management level or junior management level, you know, they were not still very clear about why did UPL acquire, what is the new strategy. And we tried to do that, but it just took time. I think for the strategy to be understood by middle management and junior management just takes time. So we followed the same process. In fact, at the lower level, the processes were more systematic and detailed, and the use of technology because of the numbers. But we felt that, you know, if we are able to keep the top team together, the signaling impact will ensure that that the disturbance which arises out of grapevines or rumors or lack of clarity will be limited. And therefore that's where my presentation was. But to not to take away the point that the hard work was done by people who did the operations or the selection level.
People and across so many geographies. For you.
Yeah, I think it was a battery of people, internal and external. The joke was that we have less employees and more consultants, but maybe sometimes it does the trick, and it does the trick because we wanted to do it in time. Because the more you delay, the more people are waiting for role clarity. It causes organization a lot of damage and many good people. So we try to create teams across markets to ensure that we do it in tight timelines, and we move very fast. I mean, we used to work overnight, no weekends, nothing. And work around the clock, because everybody's looking for clarity. Am I going to have a role or not? And if I'm going to have a role, is this going to be the same role? Is it going to be a different role? Is the different role a better role or a worse role? So that's why we moved ahead with a lot of speed. In fact, the integration got legal approval on 1st February 19, but we did share the structures as early as December 18. So I think speed was another key. Speed in giving clarity to people's role in the future, another key to ensure that people remain stable.
Okay, and we'll have to move to the next session, but I can't resist the urge to ask you another question. You know, I mean, UPL is not new to M&As, right? There have been other companies that UPL here, and we know from history and legacy of several other companies that have, you know, bought others, and companies like Tata Motors, and a long time ago when Tata Motors bought JLR and Hindalco bought Novelis, and there were companies that actually bought others who were three or four times their own size, right? Just like trying to eat something that's bigger than you. But the other approach, one is to try and integrate. The other approach is to just let it be. You know, I bought this company, let the company be there, and let it run the way it was running with a little bit of oversight from the buyer side. I'm not talking, asking you as the HR head of UPL, but as an HR expert, what would you recommend to a company that is trying to buy out another one, whether they should initially try to integrate or just let things be and settle down and then try and see where the synergies are?
So Alokesh, I think again, it's a great question, but I think the question depends upon, you know, it's like beauty is in the eye of the beholder. I think it depends upon, you know, two frame of reference in your mind. The first frame of reference is that, are they in a similar business or are they in a different business? Is Manza the same car as a Land Rover, or is it a different car, or is a Safari the same car as a Land Rover? That's the first question. And the second question is that if we run together, will we run better, or if we keep, if we let you lose like this, like we let our children lose after 20 years, after they are 21 years, maybe they turn out to be better. So I think these are the two questions. So I would feel that if the products are similar, if the marketing strategy is similar, companies should try to integrate, because then you are trying to bring both the capabilities. Second is that if you believe that a closer supervision leads to better performance, do it. But if you believe that independence leads to a better performance, give it. So let's say in the case of UPL, you will have Brazilians running the Brazilian business. You don't send anybody from India. So the finance head, the HR head, the regional head. So I think from a cultural perspective, it is always good to give a bit of autonomy. But from a business perspective, I think the critical question is, are you in the same business or are you in a different business? I mean, did you buy just because you had money, or you bought because it is the same thing that you are doing?
All right. Thank you very much, Sanjay. Please stay on and observe the rest of the program. And we have a fantastic panel discussion coming up. Thank you so much for your insights. Really, it was a pleasure having you with us.
Thank you, Lokesh.
Please stay on. So that was Sanjay Singh from UPL. And now it is time for discussion. The panel discussion is going to be on the subject, building the workforce of tomorrow. So before we begin the session, let me introduce the panel to you. We have with us Abhay Kapoor, Group HR Head of Hindware. Abhay, can you switch on your camera? Okay, we also have Mohan Singh, Group HR Head of Sterling and Wilson. Hi, Abhay. Hello, Mohan. You can unmute yourself. We have SV Kiran, Senior Vice President and Head HR of Apollo Hospitals. Vijay Sivaram, CEO, IT Staffing and Search and Recruitment, Head APAC of Quest Corp. And we have Priya Gopalkrishnan, Head HR of Team Lease Services. And last but not the least, we have Abhishek Purkayastha, Senior Sales Specialist, SAP SuccessFactors India. I'm looking forward to a great discussion. Thank you all, Priya and the gentlemen, for joining us here on this panel here today. And we had some very good insights in the first two sessions. I'm sure you would have also enjoyed them. And just before we start, there are just a few trends that I've noticed that I'd like to call out, stuff that I've been reading here and there and noticing also. One of the things that what I was talking to you about, Ashish, is this flexibility has got a completely new meaning following COVID, right? We used to talk about flexibility and flexible work hours, before COVID, but with COVID, flexibility has become the norm, right? Everything is now flexible. You cannot afford to not be. What does this do to your workforce planning, right? Will the future workforce largely work from anywhere? These are things that we need to think about. Second thing that I've noticed is that people are living longer and they're living healthier, right? A 52-year-old or a 50-year-old today is akin to a 35-year-old of 30 years ago, right? He has the same energy in general. Now, what's happening is that they're also not going to receive pension when they retire because today's norms are different, right? So these two trends taken together are forcing older people to continue to work even after they retire. But are organizations putting themselves, making themselves capable of hiring these part-time people, people with experience? Is that a trend that is out there? Even otherwise, freelancing as a career, is finding many more takers, and Priya is proof of that because Priya's organization looks at that aspect, right? So what about the free agents? People, especially in the times of COVID, a lot of people have lost their jobs, right? And there have also been the millennials whose thinking is different. They want to retire early. They don't want to be tied down to one workplace, to one boss, right? So all these things are also creating a situation where people want to stay flexible and stay away from a fixed chair. Right. So what does that do to organizations like yours who are planning a workforce strategy and a business strategy for the long term? Women, now, no matter what we say, because of the glass ceiling and other things, women are probably now, there is some evidence to suggest that women are moving away from jobs and moving into starting their own stuff, right? Job may, you know, I'm not going to get very far high. My salary is lower than the same guy who sit next to me in the same job, but he's less capable than me. So dump it. Let me go and start my own thing. What does that do to gender diversity at a time when we are talking so big on gender diversity, right? Then there is technology, automation, which is making and retiring jobs faster and faster. You know, like Ashish said, 30% of the jobs that, there earlier are not there today. And a lot of jobs that are here today will not be there tomorrow. But it's not only about the jobs. The jobs might become obsolete, but the people will not be obsolete, right? The people will still be there. So what are you doing? What are companies doing? Not about jobs, but about the people. What are the retaining programs that are happening? What are the strategies you have to keep your people, even if the jobs are changing, right? So there are so many things that are happening all around us, and really like to take note of these things and have a very focused discussion with all of you, because ultimately we are talking about building the workforce of tomorrow. And these are all trends that are happening today and that are going to influence how the workforce of tomorrow is going to be built and how you are going to handle these things, right? So maybe, you know, now that even before we actually started this, you know, networking session, we were talking about the resurgence of COVID and the fact that COVID has not gone, right? And it has come back with a vengeance, and it is probably, and Kiran was giving us some quite scary scenarios from Apollo hospitals. So the point is that I wanted to ask, you know, resilient workforce behavior and flexibility during crisis. Now the crisis, you know, when it was in the middle, we were saying, one of the questions I was asking is, are we now prepared well enough to take on the next crisis? And before you can say hello, the next crisis is on us, right? So now maybe you can tell us, have we really spent the last 12 months preparing well? So that, because this crisis has now presented us another opportunity to think about how the workforce is going to react, going to be like in the future. Right. So I'd like to just start off this debate, you know, about flexibility and how COVID has impacted, the return of COVID is impacting your workforce building. How do you think the future workforce is going to look like, given the crisis situation? Riya, you want to start?
All right. Thanks, Alokesh. And, you know, I think just to get the ball rolling, I'll talk about, you know, 2-3 trends that we are seeing from our vantage point, given the industry that we work. And I'll separate this into 2 blocks. You know, one is what was always important, and the crisis that we faced, the pandemic that we faced, has reminded us yet again that that continues to be important. That's one bucket. The other bucket is things which were emerging trends and which have got accelerated because of the pandemic and because of the VUCA world that we live in. Now, the things which were always important, but I think sometimes they got relegated a bit to the background, is in terms of basics of building good organizations, right? Fortress balance sheets, strong cash flows, having a committed workforce, making sure you've invested in your people so they stand by you during times of crisis, were all areas which were, you know, they were always important, and they will continue to be important. During the good years, I think some elements, particularly around cash flow, making sure your balance sheet is not weak from a debt to equity perspective, et cetera, were neglected. And that came back to bite a lot of organizations, which probably were most severely impacted. And we saw that also playing out in terms of the way they were looking at the workforce that they had, you know, whether in team leads or otherwise. Now, so that's one part. And I think that's important to remember. While there is a lot of change that is happening in the world, and there will always continue to be accelerated change, there are some basics about good organizations. And many of that, many of those points were covered by Sanjay and by Ashish in their presentations as well. We should never forget those, you know, in terms of chasing the new fad and so on. Now, as far as, you know, the things that got accelerated because of the pandemic is, I think, what I call as the concentric circles of employees. We always had a bunch of people who were, shall I say, builders, you know, who were committed to an organization rather than to just their work, wanted to build a career, etc. And I'll call them, for the sake of this discussion, as stayers. You also had people who were experimenters. You know, they were more committed to their work than to the organization, happy to pick up their toolbox and go to the next organization if they felt that this was not the place for them, right? So you had, and I'll call them experimenters. And you had the gig workforce, right? People who were either outsourced or even, you know, specialists, consultants, what I think Sanjay referred to as having network of networks, right? Now, each and every organization had elements of these, but I think in most places, it kind of evolved by accident. You know, you had a bunch of people who stayed because they stayed. You had a bunch of experimenters who, you know, went because they came and they went, but it wasn't thought through as a strategy. And I think what we are seeing now in HR and business conversations, you know, in our organization, and I'm sure in many, many boardrooms across the country, is how do you really plan for this? And how do you address the needs of each of these very differently? And one, you know, one point I will make here before, you know, I'm sure my other panelists would like to, you know, comment on this, is that earlier there was a notion that senior people always would be stayers, experimenters are more middle level and millennials, gig workforce is bottom of the pyramid. But we are seeing that that's no longer true. These concentric circles are really level agnostic. You can hire very senior people as consultants in a way gig, right? You can have people who are, you know, who are stayers, even though they may be, you know, at the mid or the junior level of the organization. And how are your HR processes agile enough to deal with this is a big question that we are all grappling with. The last point I want to make is that this has a major impact in terms of, you know, the areas of how do you kind of do knowledge transfer? How do you harness technology to be able to deal with this changing profile of workforce, right? Because if people are not going to be staying there with you forever and ever, you have to have very agile and rapid mechanisms to do knowledge transfer, to train, to deploy, et cetera. So I think the, you know, the entire, the interface of governance, technology into HR planning is going to become extremely crucial in boardrooms across, you know, not just India, but everywhere in the globe. I'll stop here, and I'm sure my other panelists have, you know, points to add on to this.
Sure. Who wants to go next?
Yeah. I'll take one because I always
sure.
The most similar industry to TeamLease. Combined, both of us employ more than 5 lakh plus people. So I think just to take on what Ashish and Priya had said, I think today is the choice of the fluidity of workforce that's available, right? So as an organization leader or as an organization HR head today, I think the choice is now becoming whether I need to choose a full-time employee, should I choose a contractual employee, should I outsource it to a vendor, should I do it through gig? Now, what is defining these choices? What are making the reasons to make these choices? I think it boils down to either variabilization of cost in an organization. So do I need to take this cost for the entire year? Can I contract it out for 6 months alone and get the job done? Or do I need to make this more of an outcome-based employment? Do I need to start paying employees not a fixed salary, but based on what they achieve, I pay them? And that's the whole concept of gig workers. So from just pure freelancers today, a large set of people today are task-based employers. So you pay them based on the task achieved. And therefore, today leadership, I think today chooses what is best suited for them so that their indirect cost does not deepen their books. And I think from there, it goes down to the flexibility, which you said, allocations, that it's not just about the type of resource, but okay, it's also about now, okay, can I now attract a type of talent which I couldn't earlier? Can I attract a talent that was not in my city today, but sitting somewhere else? Can I look at time parity? Can I look at maybe resources working in different time zones which are comfortable to them? But yet gives me the same outcome. You talked about gender parity, you talked about today, a lot of concepts are coming into experience parity. Am I comfortable with my leader being half my age? I think today, the flexibility is coming down to acceptance of these new norms, of understanding them, how to relate to them, how to respond to them. And I think it all boils down to that leader or that set of organization cultural values that start accepting this and then saying, okay, we are a flexible organization, not because we change things quickly, but we're willing to work in changing environments quickly.
Okay. Abhay, you know, how is this crisis helping you create the, helping you is, I don't know, it's a very sensitive word at this point, I guess, but it, you know, every crisis has its positive points. Is this return of COVID, you know, in any way helping you think about the workforce of tomorrow and what you need to do?
No, if talk about the return of, sorry, you have to bear with me. My throat is not right. Yeah. If you have to talk about the return of COVID, it's kind of a wait and watch going on. Yes, the hybrid environment continue to be there. And but over last, if we review over last 13 months, what the situation has been and how the managements have changed their thoughts and the change their the way it is working and the way they have reopened after the lockdown. I think the big shifts I can talk about is basically in the mindset of the people, particularly the mindset of the leaders, that how they look at tomorrow. From that perspective, like it has brought several changes that have important implications on the path of recovery. So one is that the situation shifts. So from unpredictability and fronting activities of the early response period to a more settled, although still uncomfortable, but there's a lot of sense of uncertainty and then dealing with that. Then the focus of leadership that expands from a very inward focus on employee safety and operational continuity to also embracing a return to the market-facing situations, envisaging the destination in terms of desired stakeholder outcomes, and just not the internal processes. The shifting of management goals from managing the crisis to keeping the organization functioning and managing the transition back to restore future. So this also requires different skill set that what are needed in to respond this kind of a phase. Then shift in the planning, like from the short-term contingency planning to mid and long-term economic and scenario-based planning, and a lot of planning related to the impact on the operations, employees, finances, and so forth. And critical to model the alignment of financial resources to the cash required to ramp up the operations. And the last but not the least shift is on the leadership attitude shift from a primary reactive mode to the anticipating how to reinvent the organization and seizing the opportunity to energize the teams by imagining a successful future and embracing the trust as a catalyst to get there. So I think these are a couple of learnings which has evolved during this crisis time, and basis these shifts, we are building the future of work for tomorrow and future of organization.
Okay, just to take that scenario planning thing that you said, you know, to Mohan, and Mohan, basically Sterling and Wilson is, you know, a kind of company that needs a lot of people physically present to do work, right? Unlike an IT services company, which can have its entire workforce sitting and working from home, you can't. Isn't it? So this, how has this changed? You know, the same question, is it more like scenario planning now? And are we losing sight of the bigger picture because of the crisis that is upon us? How are you handling things?
Yeah, so as you rightly mentioned, Alokesh, for Sterling and Wilson, it's like we are more into EPC and absolutely different than the IT-based organization where the physical presence of, you know, the individual at project has been seen as, you know, the real investment. So the moment you see the physical presence of people, that means the mentality is that the work is going on. Of course, there are a lot of measurement criteria which says that yes, work is going in the right direction. But technology, yes, it is really being more supportive. But this technology is more supportive in terms of the indirect workforce. So in EPC business like us, our focus is basically on direct versus indirect. And this combination is almost around 30 or 40 to 60, where 60% of our workforce is basically, you know, they have to be based at site. And being at site, the leverage on work from home and you know, the virtual work seems to be a little challenging right now. But yes, in last 6 months, I would say there are a couple of, you know, areas where lots of this, you know, the improvement hasn't come in terms of the technology, because technology ultimately will have to drive everything, and that's what is the it's a known fact for everyone. So basically, for the indirect workforce, yes, there is a good amount of connectivity, and I think everyone is talking about the flexibility part. And this flexibility is nothing but, you know, building more trust and working on this trust going forward in future. So this trust part is very, very important. And I must say that prior to COVID scenario, I think a virtual working setup, work from home, especially for the infrastructure and EPC company or the construction company, I think it's a dream to work from home. But COVID has really turned around everything, and it has shown one good learning to everyone, right from the leadership to the down the line to the supervisory level, that, you know, the virtual work environment or work from home also, you know, gives a lot of leverage to the organization. And also it has proved that it has improved the productivity to a greater extent. So that's really worked a lot. However, when I talk about site operations, yes, we are still working on various areas where we can bring in a lot of automation, and through automation, you know, we can make our client more happy. And most importantly, there the client expectations are basically two things. One is you know, the quality, and second is the safety. Safety of the client itself, and at the same time, when the work is going on, safety of the employees, it's very, very important. So these two areas, I think what we are looking for is the great support from the technology. And there are a lot of trial and error, there are a lot of research work is going on. And fortunately for a company like us, I must mention that, you know, we have the retirement age of 65. So that's the retirement age, and therefore the senior citizens also forms approximately 10% of the overall strength of the workforce. And what benefit we get from them is now we are realizing, because these senior citizens have a great amount of experience, different experience what they have taken in past. And these experience they are passing out to the new generation, and that is happening very seamlessly. And thanks to the technology, I think that is really helping us in terms of transformation of this knowledge from senior citizen to the millennial group. So that's how it is right now for us. And I think the journey is on. We are basically more keen on having people on board with us who are basically the forward thinker and who are basically the problem solver. Yeah.
In fact, I'm going to come to Kiran, and we'll talk about technology when we come to Abhishek after Kiran. But Kiran, basically, you know, you are in the healthcare sector, and if any industry and, you know, any sector has been in the thick of this whole COVID crisis, it has been healthcare, right? And even now, like you said, you know, before we started, that your hospitals are again full, you know, with COVID patients and all. But you cannot work remotely, right? You cannot give care in a remote fashion. Everybody has to be at the hospital, has to be working, unless, you know, the backend teams, accountants and all, that's a different thing. How are you, you know, are you, the same question that I asked Mohan, you know, is it a crisis situation where you are only going from one crisis to another and trying to just solve different scenarios, and the big picture planning is now out of the window? Or are you using this as an opportunity to think through how you can build the tomorrow's workforce?
That's a good question, Alakish. And at Apollo Hospitals, we had a scenario where we actually applied a lot of concepts that my co-panelists and the speakers have spoken till now. And you know, I was just thinking as each one of them speak, and I'm just smiling for myself that, hey, you know, we were probably one of those ones who got the first opportunity to actually implement these and see how they work. So while we were, you know, obviously thinking and were preparing for this, COVID to come to India, because it started in November 2019 and we knew it's going to come. But it's but in terms of organizational preparedness, we had to do two things. One is to prepare for the immediate crisis, and to handle crisis was to be more organized, more thoughtful, and at the same time prepare ourselves for tomorrow. Because we knew, as being in the healthcare industry, that COVID is here to stay. We knew this last year itself, so, and therefore we had to make these two things happen simultaneously. I'll quote a few examples to actually tell you how we have actually used some of these concepts right from the last 1 year, because March was when the lockdown started actually. This is one scenario for healthcare where none of us, including all our clinicians, have ever read about COVID in our textbooks or have ever seen this before. Yeah. So for us, this crisis was like, it's coming and we need to learn every day from our experiences, from the common literature that WHO or other bodies release, and therefore keep upgrading ourselves every day. Second, unlike other, you know, pandemics or other things where the healthcare workers themselves are not impacted, this is one pandemic where the healthcare workers are highly susceptible to infection and therefore they are impacted.
Correct.
So we have our members who are directly exposed to this virus. We have our members who had to really learn by the hour, by the day, as to how do you deal with this and yet stay motivated and yet stay, convinced of the fact that we are the warriors and we need to fight this battle. So when we had to do this, we had to really create the members, and we call our employers and our people as members, and therefore we had to create our members quickly, align them to the changing trend. So we bought in right from the trainings as to how do you align them, to bringing in a lot of technology. While we were on the path of a technology, we really fast-tracked it by 10x. We had to bring in technology. We need to engage with people, right? And not only our members, but their families, right? And their near and dear ones, to give them that assurance, etc. And also change the way we deliver care. You just said that, we don't have much of an option to work from home. Yes, even our managerial staff didn't have much of an option to work from home because we had to be in office to lead from the front. That's number one. While we had to be in the hospital, we had our customers who were not coming to the hospital. And it's not that COVID has come, so rest everything has stopped. People stopped getting heart attacks. People stopped getting strokes or nothing. That remains, right? And therefore, we had to transition from a physical OPD, for example, to a digital OPD. It just so happened that we launched an app called Apollo 24/7 on 5th February last year. So we were there in terms of our app, and all our consultants were available on our Apollo app. And from a physical consult, we had to transition to a e-consult, right? An actual transition, because you have to still to be available for your patients who had chronic illnesses. You had to be available for the patients who just got it and they were in a panic and so on and so forth. We moved from a physical prescription that our patient used to carry to a electronic prescription, to a physical medical records that people were very used to. So we have our own electronic medical systems, to even the patient completely accessing the electronic medical records, right? And so on and so forth. We had to do sample collections from home. We had to, deliver medicines at home. And all this when everything was shut. So we had to obviously leverage technology, redefine the, outcomes of what everybody is doing. Are all these medical legally valid or not is something that we had to, really look at, then educate people, tell them that, hey, legally you're covered because of this. At the same time, we didn't know how many, patients would come with the pandemic, with the virus and COVID, etc. And this was one time that, you need to have the doctors who are available who can take care of patients. So we had to reskill, upskill our manpower, right? Because if you had too many ICU patients, for Apollo, etc., patients usually come and they're a little sick, not just in the beginning stage. So we had our internal medicine doctors, we had our anesthetists, we have our pulmonologists get onto our ICUs because they're trained into that. So that's where you just do a quick reskilling, quick upskilling, tell them some protocols and systems, and they're there into the ICUs taking care of patients. Because somebody who is very far off takes time to come, etc. Because of the lockdown restrictions. Though you're a doctor, still you need to stop at four places and say that you're a doctor and go into the hospitals, etc. So here was a situation where you had to upskill, reskill, have the relevant number of people in the hospital, because we also had this issue of not exposing all our people to the pandemic at one go. So we had to actually split our workforce into three parts. Expose one third of the workforce at any given point of time, because there was a quarantine rules those days that if you assist a COVID patient, then you need to be on the quarantine for 14 days after 14 days of work and so on and so forth. So don't expose them to the way there. Redo the way we were looking at their facilities completely. Give them whatever is the medication or the supplements that you require to boost up their immunity. And therefore, While we do all this, right, we had a unique situation. We couldn't recruit people just because we are having more and more patients because people couldn't travel, people couldn't join, people couldn't come, etc. People who are there with us couldn't really go while their families were worried and so on and so forth. And therefore, we really had to look at what's the right number, how do you do it? And beyond hospital, we had opened something called COVID care centers by taking on hotels where we actually admitted just the symptomatic and less serious patients, and then we had to take care of them and all. So our work was expanding. Our requirement of the skill was expanding. Our number of talents that were available were limited. So we had to quickly bring in creating the workforce for tomorrow who are fully agile, right? Who are prepared for taking on the challenge, and we didn't know what the challenge and how long it is going to last. And then deliver it on the ground, then and there, every time and correct. So that's exactly what we had to do to actually build it. And today, looking back, if you see, healthcare has transitioned into virtual consults. It has transitioned into more of electronic records and more of health delivery at home. It has transitioned into some of our offices more using technology for meetings and other things, because physical meetings are always more riskier than meetings on the technology. And therefore, what could have taken probably next 5 years have happened in 5 months as far as healthcare is concerned.
Indeed it has. And in fact, we see that trend across industries, across functions. And with that, I'll come to Abhishek. And basically, Abhishek, what I've noticed is that before COVID, technology companies, vendors would chase companies and say, implement this technology is good for you. Now it's the other way around, isn't it? Where companies are actually chasing and saying, when are you going to get this thing deployed? And I need this, I have this problem, I need this solution. The tables seem to have turned a bit, and it's good because it brings in greater efficiency and productivity also, right? At the same time, there's automation and there is some fear in the mind that what will happen to my job, if technology comes in and robots come in, and RPA especially is looked at with a great deal of suspicion, right? Robotic process automation. So tell us a little bit about leveraging technology to redefine work outcomes and, make sure that the workforce is also motivated.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks a lot, Alokesh. Really, really glad to hear that so many industry leaders have definitely mentioned the importance of technology in these trying times. Now, one thing, I heard recently and I would like to share is that there are basically three kind of work, right? If you see, one is the hand work, the heart work, and the mind work, right? Now, the hand work is something that we will typically let the robots, the RPAs of the world take it over. And that is how it has been, even in the manufacturing industry, it has been, right? When you see whatever was the handwork per se, which is repetitive tasks with certain rules, you could automate it. Whereas the heart and the mind work still remains with the humans, right? So that's a safe part to be. The heart and the mind part will definitely continue to be with the humans. Of course, to some extent, AI is coming in, but that still is good.
I was going to say that.
So now if you see from the point of view of building a resilient workforce behavior during the pandemic, what we have seen is that a lot of companies they have leveraged technology during this time to identify the workforce sentiments during these uncertain times, and it helped organizations pinpoint the exact concerns that bothered employees, where it was whether it was extended work hours or mental health issues. And once the organization was able to identify the problem, they could create a digital intervention around that problem. One of the training courses that we found was very commonly utilized across organizations was for managers on how to manage remote teams better. That was one of the most popular courses we saw during the COVID times. And also, if you see, resilience, of course, the definition given by Ashish.
I think some of the managers you're speaking to are also in the audience because they are asking the same question. How do you keep the remote people motivated?
Absolutely. Yeah, so and if you see, but the definition of resilience given by Ashish at the beginning of this event, right? So by definition, it refers to the ability of overcoming difficult situation. So, technology definitely helped build this ability by identifying how stretched the employees were and how effective the managers were in managing the workflows. And also what we're seeing is that, technology has really helped improve operational efficiency across the hire to retire process. I mean, the process which typically the HR owns. Now we see a lot of customers of SAP, especially who had a strong HR technology backbone. They could run, you know, they could run this process quite seamlessly since they already had a backbone in place, compared to others who were a little lagging in terms of the technology adoption. Now I would like to share a small story of an organization when they went about the digital transformation and how it helped them during the pandemic. It's about a global retail sports goods company. Now during the early days of the pandemic, this organization began to sell a very comfortable mask to the medics. Now originally this mask was designed for snorkeling. However, some designers realized that these masks could make excellent makeshift ventilators. And so they created a valve using a 3D printer and then worked with this organization to get the original 3D plans to make sure it fitted perfectly. Now, because the company had a very strong digital backbone, with the real-time inventory system, they could find exactly where all the masks were located. They could pull everything back from the market to the hospitals which needed them. And that was something which really created a huge impact to the society and the community that they were working in. And thanks to their data-driven technology and transformation effort, this organization is really able to remain agile and resilient and as well as flexible in this phase of change. So that's my view, Alokesh.
Okay, in fact, I'll take the same question to the others. And technology is changing a lot of things, right? Including our workforce and how we view our workforce. How is this going to influence your particular company or your industry? How do you think your workforce is going to look any different, let's say, in 2030 than it looks now because of the changes that technology is bringing? This is open to the panel.
I'll take a dig at it. I think what we are doing here, because we've amassed a workforce of 350,000 people, it kind of creates two significant problems of how do you connect regularly, how do you engage. So I think one of the things that we have taken as a practice is rebranding the word engagement to experience. This has happened in customer journeys for many companies. They have rebranded and re-serviced customer journeys to be more experience driven. I think engagement today is becoming more transactional. Did you get your salary on time? Did you get your payslip on time? Did you get your compliance managed? But I think organizations are moving towards being more experienced. How are you going to connect with your employees more often? Are you reaching the across levels, across functions? Are you able to talk to them, engage with them, give them experiences to make them do better in what they do? Goes back to the point of, how can they be more productive and enjoy it at the same time? And I think as an organization, I think that's what we're pushing a lot, to seeing how employees can become more productive, but at the same time enjoying. It doesn't always have to be review of metrics and review of numbers. It also means about maybe they have a hobby they're pursuing. How can you engage that better? If there's a sport they're following, how do you get them to do something different virtually? We started something called the Quest Crew, where we invited our employees to come perform a song. And it became completely viral, where people started singing. And even those who cannot sing that well, I must add, many of us as well, wanted to be part of it because it was something that we all took part together. And I think it creates more experience and livelihood, because let's accept the fact they're not physically in office. And there is a little bit of social anxiety to connect, to feel connected. And a lot of synergies, innovation come through these connect. And it's important that, so I think shifting that brand of employee engagement to employee experiences, I think will certainly help. And technology is a huge driver.
Employee engagement to employee experience. It's sounds interesting. Mohan, you've unmuted your mic. You have something to say about what your future workforce is going to look like?
See, as you rightly all mentioned that, the importance of technology is definitely there. And if you really see what technology really does for us, it's basically makes our employees more productive. And how part is very, very important to understand. Because most of the time, imagine there is what happens to the employee, everything goes to his mind and to his heart, as somebody rightly mentioned. And these are the two areas it got, completely overloaded. And that's how a lot of stress and lots of delay in decision-making and so on and so forth. There is a laundry list, if you talk about the disadvantages of not having a technology. With the help of this automation, what happens is now there are so many wonderful tools available. So many things are available and an employee has nothing to lose there. But to just completely rely on the technology and feel absolutely relaxed and enjoy the moment of their employment in any organization wherever they are. Like, for example, when you talk about having an interaction, you know, with your Teams call or your Zoom call, couple of things, you know, which managers are basically practicing, and that's very important to further take the advantage on the technology is make technology our friend rather than creating it as a pressure point. For example, if there is a review meeting or if there is some kind of another cross-functional meeting where the rules and regulations are like, you know, keep your camera on, keep the height of the camera at this level, that level, and all that, which sometimes, you know, create a lot of pressure for the employees or for the other stakeholders. But normally what we do, I mean, in our organization, there are a couple of informal practices which managers place every day. It's basically making people comfortable, saying that, okay, in case, you know, you are okay, keep your camera on, otherwise keep it off. And what happens when the camera is off? You know, the people becomes more multitask. You know, at a time, he's handling so many things. He is replying to your, you know, question. He is listening to you. At the same time, he's replying to so many messages. Because today, the role of a human being is completely different than what it was before. So it makes you more multitask. It makes you more productive because you are completely engaged. You are happy. And this is how the role of the manager, I would say, it's a very important for the role to for the manager to play by taking advantages of the technology. So very important time now for all of us to recognize the IT, to recognize the AI part, to recognize the automation, and to appreciate them so that they, you know, in return, give it back to the human being.
Sorry, I was on mute. I saw Priya switch, you know, unmute herself and then mute herself back again. You wanted to
speak? I'm conscious of time, and I think we are coming to the end of the session. So, but just one point I wanted to make is that employees are, just one point, which is that, you know, I find that people in the organization, as customers, when they're looking at the outside world, they're used to technology which is really, really friendly, right? I mean, you look at the Uber experience, the Amazon experience, etc. And I see that impacting a lot in terms of the way they expect the systems within the organization to be. And there's a technology part to it. There's also a process part to it. And I think our biggest job of leaders is to make sure that we are able to, for the people who are working in our organizations, make the experience of their work as seamless as, you know, as they would experience as a customer, you know, with some other platform. Yeah? And I think, you know, earlier, because we were all co-located, you know, you could reach out to somebody, and there was a tolerance for, you know, slack in process, heaviness in process. As we become more remote, you know, and flexible in our workforce engagement, I think that job is going to become really crucial of leaders to be able to make sure that process and technology put together allows employees to be far more, you know, I would say seamless and be able to do their work more easily as compared to earlier.
Abhay, you also switched on.
Wait, okay. So
apart from what you're going to say, there is also the thing about how you must have had a lot of remote teams also, right? So how did you manage to keep them motivated? You can just add that at the end of your thing.
Yeah, so what I feel is the constant communication is the key. How you engage with the people when they are working remotely, and how are you connecting with them on a more frequent basis? How are you engaging with them in terms of not only monitoring the task or deadlines or tracking the progress, but also understanding the way they are operating, what are their requirements, how they are feeling about the work. And most of the time, like, especially when we see that in the hybrid working, when people are coming to the office on some of the days they are allowed to come to the office, there we found that how are we able to utilize that time in terms of managing the best of the best possible ways. The other possibility which has happened due to this is working anytime, anywhere. Now, anywhere is okay, but anytime is becoming a big issue wherein people are working really stretched hours, not having enough time for their daily routines. So from that perspective, ensuring all that is happening, and HR teams are particularly engaging when during the work from home on the gamifications of various activities for engaging with the people. I think these are a couple of things which are helping productivity up and engaging the people. And definitely not don't forget the reward and recognition. So reward and recognition has been something which usually has been happening on the physical platforms. So how to create reward and recognition platforms and how to celebrate those reward and recognitions, like all people sitting at the home, and when we are doing R&Rs, sending the goodies packets to each one's house at the same time, and all these kind of things, which has really helped us in engaging the people.
Kiran, you also wanted to say something. I think Sanjay, you have come back. You also have a point to make on the technology aspect.
I'm being sensitive to time, so I'll just say a couple of sentences. We have really leveraged technology in HR at Apollo to actually reach out to our members. We have actually focused on the experience piece more than the engagement piece. And therefore, we coined what we call as My HR at My Fingertips. And that's there what you find in all our communications, wherein not only we reached out to their safety, but we reached out into their comfort. So we literally took routine HR processes and what matters to them, literally to their mobile. And we have done that in the last 10 months while we were going through this pandemic, so that we stand by them. So technology really helps in terms of enhancing the experience, enhancing the productivity. They never had to come out of their workstation, be by the side of the patient, etc. Was made it accessible anywhere. Anytime, I heard Abhay saying that in our case, anytime was also relevant because we work 24/7, and therefore anytime. Overall, making our workforce feel that the company cared for them.
Right. So Sanjay, since you're here, why don't you take this question also? How is technology changing your work?
I think the answer is pretty simple. Technology is a great enabler. It's a tool. And like every tool, it all depends upon the individual. How does he really make the best of the tool? The second point which we should not miss is the context. When all your other tools have been taken away from your reach because of COVID-19, you can't reach office, you don't have that massive infrastructure of IT, you don't have somebody helping you fix your laptop or buy a new one. It all depends upon what really you make the best of the tool. And the third is that how much are you trying to learn the tool than to find the fault with the tool? So, you know, this whole debate about, you know, my generation versus your generation. I mean, I think COVID-19 killed that debate. You have to say it's my generation if you want to be effective. So I would say technology is a great tool. You can transfer knowledge, you can transfer data, you can transfer work, you can give solutions. Maybe not for every job which requires a pair of hands and a pair of legs, but most knowledge jobs. But it also tells you that in a world where the world is so globally integrated, there's something which happens in Hubei province is going to impact US much more than China or much more than Vietnam. We will have to be prepared to use technologies and any other tool which help us manage crisis. You cannot be dependent upon a massive infrastructure all around yourself. You need to leverage the infrastructure which is coming to you in any form whatsoever. I think that's a big learning. The big learning is make the best of what you have.
Okay. Abhishek, you know, we are out of time, but I will take one last question to you, and which is basically, you are the technology sort of, expert here, and you're also the technology vendor here. You're meeting a lot of people in the market, right? So tell me two things. One is, which areas are you seeing HR functions investing more in technology, and which areas do you think they should invest more when they're thinking about technology?
Yeah, so very clearly, Alokesh, what we're seeing is there is a lot of investment happening on the digital learning platform, because, earlier the learning budgets would be primarily for classroom trainings. And that is significant, and that is, logistically a big challenge now. So we are seeing there's a huge investment moving on to e-learning, which should be on the tip of the finger, like what Mr. Kiran mentioned, right? My HR at my fingertips, right? So that's the expectation even for a learning platform, wherein they would expect the learning to be right on the fingertips and they could do it whenever they want to. I mean, you shouldn't have a predefined schedule for them to attend a training course. They would like to do the when they would like to do that. That's one area. The second area is again around the employee experience part of it, wherein people, organization wants to become listening organizations, right? They just do not want to convey messages from top. They want to understand what is the pulse at the ground, especially during the pandemic times. They want to understand what the organizations are feeling right now. So that's where we are seeing a movement towards employee experience kind of flat platform, wherein they're trying to gather the pulse of the ground, what is happening, and become a listening organization. So these are two areas we are seeing significant traction. Another area that definitely everyone should look at is, of course, from an end-to-end HR digitization platform point of view, right? I mean, it makes sense when you have everything in one platform talking to each other, ideally on the cloud, so that the dependence on the infrastructure, which Sanjay sir was talking about, of a infrastructure. I mean, see, end of the day, as a technology company, we are the best to manage that, because that's our core competency of managing the technology part of it. So let the technology vendor manage that part of it, and only the solution part should be visible to the end user, which is the employees in this case, through whichever device they want to access.
Okay, I'll request Ashish to come back. Ashish, I believe you're still here. Yeah, thank you so very much.
Yeah.
Ashish, one last question to you before we wrap up, since we are having this panel, which is that, do you feel that during this period, have you observed any fall in motivation among your employees, especially because, you know, paints again is a very physical kind of thing, right? People have to go and paint houses and paint industries and cars and buildings and factories, isn't it? And you have to manage a lot of remote teams. Is there a loss of motivation? How do you keep the spirits up? What's your strategy for that?
Yeah, so I think the pandemic also has been a very long pandemic, right? So we've had this situation now for about 12 to 14 months. I think in the initial phases, it was not so much about motivation. I think there was eagerness in, you know, a lot of employees to do more than what, what they normally would have done, take the risk, go out there, so that was not so much of a concern. Of course, we are also a very, manufacturing organization. We deal with, dealers who are our primary partners. We don't sell to end consumers directly too much right now still. So that interface needed, a lot of motivation for people to go out there. Coming out of their comfort zones and be out and show the way in that sense to the organization. So that required, I think, that motivation is also infectious. I think when you see one part of the organization and one part of the element going out and getting rallied behind it, a lot of the other take a lot of solace from that and drive towards it. So that was enabling. But at the same time, as time goes along, I think that the motivation or the need for providing that motivation in a remote working environment will only increase. I think a lot of people have talked about, having a regular connect. Sanjay mentioned, though in a different context, which was very rightly put, of, you can't do, there's nothing called over communication, right? I think a very valid point and holds so very true in this, in this context, right? So when you're remote and away, that need is so high that, you can't just, over-communicate. But at the same time, motivation in different forms, getting people together, creating environments where they can interface, interact, I think are also roles that, the HR team can play a lot. Of course, the business leaders have to really, drive that.
Thank you very much. And it has been a fantastic, session. One of the things, big things that I really take away from this is the aspect of employee experience. It is something that I came across even before COVID, and you would know that Mr. Vineet Nair of HCL, he had come up with this employee first, concept, right? For which he was widely recognized, that your employee is your first customer and you keep your employees happy, your customer will be happy. So this phase of crisis has only accentuated that need, where you make the employee experience stronger, and nothing like technology tools and cloud definitely to ensure consistency of that experience. Thank you all very much for coming and joining and engaging with us. We will take a group photo with all of you, as in a group screenshot. So you all need to look into your camera and smile. And my team at the back end, Nidhi, she is going to take the photo. Nidhi, tell us when to do and when you're done.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for coming and joining us. Thank you to all the audience people who have joined and listened to us. We'll keep in touch.
Goodbye. Thank you, Alokesh. Thank you,
everyone. Thank you, Alokesh.
Thank you.
Thank you.